Goedemiddag.
Welcome. Welcome everybody to this session on the impact of open applied science. We are going to look into an example of open applied research. We're going to see what benefits it brings, what difficulties, and I hope we can all learn from it. My name is Eva. I'm your host for this session. And at some point, I will tell you about the way that CERF tries to support open applied science. But the headliners of this session are Dané Bodewes, researcher at Fontis, and Wim Reel, member of the board of Mensa. And they will introduce themselves in a bit now. They're not here in the studio, but they will be part of this session from a distance. We have a chat. Please make use of it if you have any questions. Don't be shy. I hope we can make this an interactive session and we'll try to answer them all. Okay, so that's the program for today. And before we go ahead, I think it's good to take some time for the concept of applied science, because it's not a very common or well-known fact. I got a bit lost there. But the type of practice of the type of research that universities of applied sciences are performing is not that common, not that well known as academic research, for example. They are performing this type of research officially since 2001. So that's over two decades. In a way, that's quite well, but in contrast to the academic traditions of university, it's quite new and not that long here. It's shaped by the lector. It hasn't got a real good translation in English, because the whole division between fundamental academic research and applied science in terms of organizations, that's quite unique for the Netherlands. But here, a lector is, well, you can see it as a professor in applied sciences, and he works or she works together with docent onderzoekers or teacher researchers. These are people that usually teach at a university of applied science and next to that do some research. And you have researchers that combine their research in a university of applied science with their career outside of the university. So that's to have a better understanding of the context. And then the open part. I think we can make the statement that open is a very logical and natural way for applied science. And why is it? Well, first of all, societal impact is the main goal and the most important reason for the existence of applied science. So it's not more than logical that that the society can have good access to the results and the results. Second of all, it's interdisciplinary by nature. It involves complex, relevant societal issues that ask for a multidisciplinary approach. And you need a lot of different skills and a lot of different perspectives for this. So that makes open a really good fit to share the ideas and to have an open approach. And third, applied sciences is always done together with education and society. So those three are partners in it. And to create new partnerships, to bring up new ideas, open is a very logic way to go about in this field. So that's for a start. Then that's enough for me for now. I will gladly give the word to Dané and Wim, who will tell a bit more about their work and their link to open science and why they are here today. First, I hope we can speak with Dané.
Okay, hello. Thank you, Eva, for this introduction.
Let's see, I cannot see the slide, the first slide of my presentation.
It's there.
Yeah, it's there, okay. So yeah, as you can see, my research, I work for the Fontys University of Applied Sciences for a research group, Industrial Engineering and Entrepreneurship. And my research focuses on the diversity and power of curiosity. And this research is based or started out of a sense of wonder. Because I think we all know how we celebrate and praise the curiosity of small children. And curiosity is also promoted as essential for learning and for innovation. However, in real life, I noticed that many people amongst which teachers experience difficulties in recognizing curiosity. And because of this reason, but also because of other reasons, it seems that they cannot stimulate or facilitate curiosity as good as we would expect. So that led to my research. I wanted to know, how can we recognize curiosity in real life? So not by testing it or by using all type of fancy techniques, but how just in real life can a teacher, a manager, or a parent recognize curiosity? And also, why would we want to stimulate and facilitate curiosity? Okay, we know it's good for learning and innovation, but are there other reasons? Because if we want people to stimulate curiosity to improve learning and innovation, and then people have to be motivated for it. So I wanted to know what motivates people to want to stimulate and facilitate it. Well, so I started to do research. I started to do a literature research. And based on that literature research, I formulated interview questions, and I started to interview very curious people, because I really wanted to know how do they experience curiosity, and how do they use it for their professional and personal development. Well, I learned a lot from those interviews. I recognized theory, but I also found some facts that contradicted the theory, so that led to further research. And what was for me the most valuable was also that I learned how people experience but also talk about their curiosity. You can read a lot of academic articles about curiosity. It can be quite complex to understand that literature. But if we want to stimulate curiosity, we have to use normal language that people can recognize and relate to. And of course, I also heard a lot of questions from the people who I interviewed and problems that they encountered while following their curiosity. So this was all very relevant information for me, which I used to develop trainings about curiosity. So I trained many teachers and students. And I collected a lot of data against during those curiosity workshops, because I always asked people about their own curiosity. So in this way, I managed to translate theory to practice, but also to add some more relevant insights to the theory that already existed. Well, today we will also talk about a project that I did about how to help highly gifted students flourish. How did this happen? In fact, this was another case of wonder. What happened is I interviewed many very curious people, persons, and more than once, I wondered, is this person in front of me a highly gifted person? Because I already knew that that curiosity is one of the characteristics of giftedness. And I decided to contact a professor who does research on giftedness. We had a talk, and this resulted in the in the research that we will talk about today. So this is my introduction to my research and also about the project that Mensa Nederland and Fontis worked on.
Yeah, thank you, Dade. I think you do a lot of interesting stuff we could fill up the whole afternoon with, but we won't because we have another speaker here, and that's Wim. Wim, could you introduce yourself?
Yes, I can, of course. Thank you. And thank you, Danae, for the introduction on the project. Well, I first want to tell you, the audience, a bit about Mensa Nederland and Mensa as the worldwide organization for those who don't know us. In fact, the theme of which I want to talk about is we want to offer valuable assistance to researchers and projects dealing with intelligence. That is what we did in this case. I will go to the second slide. I hope I don't see it.
Yes, it's perfect.
There? It's there. Okay. No, that's the this one first. No.
Yeah.
I miss one.
It's Mensa Purposes now.
Yeah, but it should be Mensa the High Acuous Society.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think it's not there.
Not there?
No.
Okay. Well, I will tell it then without the sheet. Well, Mensa, it's the second name, in fact, is the High Acuous Society. And who are the members? The members, well, if you want to be a member, the only relevant qualification for membership is scoring within the upper 2% of the general population on an approved intelligence test. You can do this intelligence test at Mensa, or you can do it with by a psychiatrist. Mensa has members of all agents in more than 100 countries around the world, and Mensa in the Netherlands has around 4,000 members. And what we do is that we provide our members with a very diverse and exciting opportunities for social, cultural, and intellectual interaction. Then we go to the second slide, and that should be purposes. Yes?
Yes.
Well, we have purposes which are valid for all the Mensa countries all around the world. And those are three purposes. The first one is to identify and foster human intelligence for the benefits of humanity. Second is to encourage research into the nature, characteristics, and uses of intelligence. And the last one is to provide a stimulating intellectual and social environment for its members. The last slide I want to show you is, well, what I said at first is that we want to offer valuable assistance to research and projects dealing with intelligence. And there are four things which we can offer. That is, of course, knowledge. We know a lot about intelligence. There are a lot of people within our society who can say things about that. We have a very large network of people who are working within the intelligence sector. Of course, we have a lot of members, and researchers do use these members, not using them, but, well, we if they want to talk to people who are highly intelligent, we can ask our members if they want to cooperate in such a research. And lastly, we have a lot of contacts and communications with a lot of people who are interested in intelligence, not only within our society, but of course outside as well. Well, that's a short introduction about our society.
Okay.
That was also my last sheet.
Yes, Thank you. Sorry for the missing sheet, but I think your introduction was quite clear anyways. So we now have a researcher and we heard the society, to go a bit short. I have prepared some questions for them about how they and why they do open research. If you have any questions, please let me know. Use the chat. This is your opportunity to ask anything you want to know of them. My first question would be, what does open look like in your research, in this research project you did together? And I think, Danae, maybe you can go first in answering.
Yes, so, of course I knew, I expected this question, so I prepared a slide, which we just saw a few seconds ago.
The slide is here,
ago.
Yeah.
In fact, in my general research, I started to share my research from the start on. With the first interviews that I did and the first thoughts I had about my research, I shared it by writing blogs, sharing articles on LinkedIn, all the interviews I did, the whole interview itself, and also my reflection on it from theory I shared via social media, and also the interviews. I was invited for interviews, and some videos were made about talks that I gave, and these were all shared by social media. Other products that I developed and which were shared really are, for example, a curiosity module that I developed together with a department of Fontys University. We can go back one slide. We developed games and a toolbox to stimulate curiosity amongst students. There are many ways that that I share my research results. One of the bigger projects is that I'm also writing a book about lifelong curious, and that I made contributions to other books. And then, of course, the, one of the examples is also the research I did on how we can help highly gifted students flourish by addressing their curiosity. And that's the next slide. So we did a research on it with a research group, and I don't know if you can see the website here. This is the website of the research group, Good Teachership, Good Leadership. And here we shared all the results of the research. So the research reports, but also some tools that we developed. So there's a knowledge chart, with knowledge about how highly gifted students would like to see their education and how they experience their education. Then there are some tips for teachers, how they can best coach students. And there are also some experience cards. And this are some, there are 9 paradoxes about the needs and behavior of highly gifted students, which might seem contradictory, but in fact are very logical when you know a bit more about how a highly gifted person thinks.
Okay. So
so there are some tools, also a workbook about curiosity, and we shared all those tools and the reports, we shared them during workshops. So again, we use social media to announce that we had finished our research and that people could download the tools for free, and that they could also attend our workshop for free. We did this during several occasions, such as the week of lifelong learning, the week of giftedness, and the week of feedback literacy. Well, these are just a few examples of how we shared the knowledge that we found by doing research.
Okay, so open is not just, if I hear it correctly, open is not just not putting the results not behind a paywall, but it has a, you have a really active approach. You actively reach out to the people that you do your research for, and you put it. It's in the way in the forms of the research results. It's not just an article that only can be understood by peers, but these are practical things you can use well in everyday life.
Exactly, and also by, for example, giving workshops on the topic. It's not only a way to share information, but you also get feedback and you get questions from people who attend the workshop. And this is, again, input for research. So in this way, I or the research group can understand better the needs of for example, teachers who have to coach or teach highly gifted students. So this makes it helps you to make your research more practical.
Yeah. And well, I get a question from someone in the audience. She asks, it's a question for Danae. Do you have any figures how often the products you developed are used or downloaded by others?
No, I don't. I have that. I should ask that, and I think it's a good question because this is, something, of course, that I'm very curious about. And I would not only like to know how much it was downloaded, but also, how people experienced it. What's if it was valuable to them, or useful to them, or not, and how they used it. Because I did receive quite some emails from people who use the tools in very unexpected ways. So that was really interesting to hear.
Okay, yeah, well, and so it's not only just sending out, but make it a dialogue, an open dialogue between the researcher and the users. And Wim, I was wondering, you just told us that Mensa is a partner in several types of research projects. Do you, have you participated maybe in less open research projects, or is this in your experience quite common to share the results of the research that you participate in so openly?
Well, the research is, so far we participated in were not that open as this one. Okay. So they were mostly done in cooperation with people who are working on universities, and some are spread around, but not all of them. So yep. this one was the most open of them.
Yeah. And I get another question before we head on to something else. Someone is asking, I think it's for you, Danae, if you're already sharing the research data you collect during the research.
We're not actively sharing it, but if people are interested and they share with us what they want to use it for, then we can share the information.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you. It sounds very good and nice. Like you benefit a lot of people with your work, and you get some feedback. But are there any, from both of your perspective as a stakeholder and a researcher, are there any negative sides of this? Are there any blockades, difficulties, or negative consequences? Maybe Wim, can I start with you? Do you, for example, go ahead.
Well, so far, I don't see any negative consequences, because what I see is that if more people have access to the research results, in this case, more people can be aware and hopefully think about what it is, intelligence, high giftedness. Yeah. And that the results and the tools are used in the daily life and in a professional life. So in the case of this research the teachers will learn more about how to deal with students who are highly gifted, so that they will be supported and guided in a way that suits them best. And that in that case, the paradoxes which are written out show well what works well and what doesn't work that well. So
it supports the purpose of Mensa.
What?
It supports the purpose of Mensa, sharing the research.
It supports definitely the purpose of Mensa,
Okay. Well, and Danae, in your experience as a researcher in this project or maybe other projects or in general?
Well, what we notice as a research group, well, it's a very practical result, is that, in fact, we get so much enthusiastic response. And this was not part of course, when we start a research, we need time, we need budget to do research, because unfortunately we cannot just do anything, we just make up and we are curious to know. So there's always a limited amount of time and money available to do the research, and in fact now the research is closed, but this creates a lot of opportunities for us, but also it asks quite some time to and answer all the questions that people give or to respond to the opportunities that that occur because of the work that we did. And of course, this seems like a luxury problem, but it can also be a bit frustrating that you feel limited in the possibilities that you have to respond well to this.
Yeah, so you have to make time to follow up the response you get.
And yes, so of course, we have to look for new, we have to start up new research, find funding for that, but you accumulate more and more work for yourself, which is really fascinating. And I think a lot of researchers do this, are willing to spend a lot of free time on this. But it does create some problems in time management.
And I get another question that's maybe also could be a negative part of it. It says some researchers are afraid that they cannot exploit their tools commercially anymore. Is that important for you too?
For me personally, not. And even for this research, it is for this research group, it's very important that we all know of each other that we don't want to use this for commercial purposes. But I can imagine that for some research, it is important, as I said, finding funding for your research is an important part of the work.
Something else, well, a bit in line with this, you work together with Mensa, which is a society. Do you have any experience in working with a company? Because for Mensa, it really supports you share the same goal to be as open as possible about the knowledge, to spread it wide, but maybe for a company that puts the same efforts and time in a project. Is it any different, or is that just not an issue in your field?
Well, I do have some experiences, but then there. I think it's more. I have worked more to research companies, and not that they were an active partner in a research. However, we are thinking about doing a research about highly gifted employees or highly gifted professionals, and then it would be very interesting for us to work with together with a company and see if they would be interested in participating in this research, and that would create new challenges to see indeed how. how we share the intellectual property rights about certain things that we would develop or not.
Okay. Well, if there are not any more questions from the public for this part, I was wondering, you are both starting a new project together shortly. I was wondering, what have you learned from the experience so far on specifically on opening up your research that you will take into this new project, and what do you definitely not want to reuse again? Maybe Wim, are you is it a steady as you go, or do you see a new approach in this new project?
What was important in this project is that people have some kind of idea of highly gifted people, and these ideas are not always correct. So in this case, teachers working with students, it's very important that they know that although people with high intelligence should be able to study well, it's not always the case. They need support and guidance as well. And it's the way that they look at it, or the way that they study, is different. And they are different in a way. And that's why this research is so important, in fact, for this, for those people, the highly gifted people, and for us as community. And if we can take this and use it in the next research as well, that would be very nice.
So you have to raise more. You have to raise more awareness about the problem amongst the people that you do the research for, the people you hope that are going to use the tools that you develop.
There are a lot of thoughts and ideas about gifted people which are not always correct. It's important for all those who are working with gifted people to be aware of that. And that's why we are so glad with this research. In this case, the teachers learn a lot more.
Okay. Yes. And thank you. And Danave, what is your biggest lesson that you take from the former project on, opening up the research?
I would say that mainly, I think also on this project, the project that we did, I noticed that I was less open in the beginning than I was with the research that I normally do. So in the next project, which we still have to define and also find funding for, but it's not... sure that we can do the research, but we definitely have ambitions to do further research. But for that, I think I would start to share more earlier in the project, and also make even more use of Mensa Nederland as a platform to reach the target group. So that would be, I think that would help us also accelerate the research and also to get more more diverse and larger sample.
Okay. And that's, the question I get from the audience is at this moment, in addition to your contribution to open science that you just described, are you taking any extra steps to ensure your results reach the teachers and families supporting highly gifted children? So that's maybe you just thought about the opening in the earlier stage, but how about the part when the project is closed? Is it ever closed?
The research was, the focus was mainly on the professionalization of teachers on the subject of giftedness. So what we do is we share the research findings also on places where Fontys teachers can find more information about this. Also for the students themselves, for example, at the student affairs, they will be able to access this information. For the parents of highly gifted students, we did not organize a specific place for them to find the information. We hope that social media and also the students themselves might guide their students to find this information. This is at least what we heard very often, that they shared the information with their teachers or with their parents or with, for example, their company where they were doing the internship. So in this way, we are trying our best. What we also have an a work group at Fontis where we are slowly creating a network of Fontis colleagues who are gifted, highly gifted themselves, or who have knowledge of giftedness and who are willing to act as a contact person for students and teachers in the different departments of Fontis. So in this way, we are really try actively to share this information. And next to that, there's also other platforms, for example, the platform Giftedness in Higher Education, HBHO. And on this website, the results are shared as well. And this is a national platform for highly gifted students.
Okay. Oh, that's a lot of outreach, I guess. I find yours, both of your experience really inspiring, both the research itself as the way that you are so open about sharing it. Given the time of the program, I'm going to the last final question. Do you have any advice? If you could give one short advice to either researchers or research supporters or well, other companies or societies on practicing open science, what would it be? Maybe Wim, could you go first?
Well, the advice I would give, it's from Mental Netherlands, of course. We are glad with researchers who want to research on intelligence, on intellectual giftedness and other fields which are related to that. So if you have a thought in doing that, yeah, please consider make contact with us, because we are a worldwide organization with a lot of contacts, and we might be able to help you. And well, if that could lead to something like this, which was a very nice and fruitful cooperation, that would be very nice.
Thank you. That well, who knows who's listening to this call to action now? And Danae, any wise words?
Well, I have two tips. The first one is, of course, follow your curiosity, because that makes research fun to do. You will become more enthusiastic, and when you're enthusiastic about your research, you make other people enthusiastic and curious about your research. So I think this is very important in when you're open, that you're also sharing it from out of enthusiasm. And what I really learned from this project is how important it is to develop easy to use tools. I noticed that this really made people enthusiastic and far more enthusiastic than sharing research reports or other elaborate studies. People need things that they can use now and that they can share with others without having to study a document for hours to understand what they can do with it.
Well, thank you. Clear, loud and clear, I would say. And it's a nice, well, transition to the final part of this session. Well, Wim and Danae, thank you very much for answering the questions. Not all questions, I've missed some, but well, we have short time now. Dané and I worked together on creating an open science a tool to make it more easy to share all the results of applied science, especially those results she just called, not just the articles, but all the different sizes and shapes there are. It's a project led by 12 universities of applied sciences, led by the University of Applied Science of Amsterdam, SIA, it's the NWO part of for applied sciences, and the Association of Universities of Applied Sciences, and they've asked CERF to coordinate this, and the common goal is creating means to make applied science visible, accessible, and available to all the people that could benefit from it. It's been quite a journey together. We started some years ago, and first we focused in a lot of interviews, workshops, group discussions on what's the problem, what's blockading you in sharing your knowledge as open as you would like to. Then we went into the phase where we zoomed in a bit more on how could a solution be formed, what could it look like. That's what we are now, and next we're going into the phase, hopefully, where we're going to see how can we transition this from project to service. Well, it's good to know we're not the first to think about these problems. There's a lot of preparations done by all the universities of applied science and the other societies as well, and we take all this experience into account. So what could the solution look like? It's not definitive yet. We try to create a lot of space for our wonder and new insights. But at the moment, we see two parts, a tool part, a website that connects different sources of information that already are there, and which supports researchers to expose their knowledge and to share it easily on both this platform and other platforms as well, and to make it more easy to find and connect and to bring together, well, societies like Mensa and researchers who are looking for them. And we have, well, we're trying this now in some sort of mock-ups. You can see them now. And because, well, technique on its own is never a full solution, we're working on an organization with editors that can make showcases of societal impact, community management, to do it all together, and, well, make sure it all keeps on working. Editors made already some of the, well, different forms that Dané just told about as well, not just articles. Well, that whole project is called the National Platform for Applied Sciences. We're almost out of time here, so my last slide would be, where can we find more information? I saw someone thanking the researchers in name of her daughter on doing the great work they do. If you want to talk more about curiosity or high giftedness or the tools we create to share open applied science, here you can find the addresses. And then for now, I would say I hope you have an inspiring day. Good luck, have fun with the rest of the program, and I hope to see you soon in some other way.